Namaste, welcome all of you. Now Shyamji will give recap of yesterday's session. Ram Ram.
Hey guys, good morning or good noon. I hope that you guys all had fun yesterday, right? Today we learned a lot of new things, right? We learned about global timescales. Like, right, we are in the year 2020, that we say like 2020 AD. But our, like, you know, the time scale according to our Sanatana Dharma goes back like thousands and tens and thousands, even millions of years. Like yesterday, Rani Sadashiva Garu said that the Kali Yuga, the total length of Kali Yuga is 432K years, like 432K, 432,000 years is one Kali Yuga. And the Yuga before that is twice. And the Yuga before that is four times of that Kali Yuga. So scales are huge. Like, you know, it goes even beyond Big Bang, probably. And yesterday, Sadashiva Garu talked a lot about various cool rishis and what cool powers they had, right? We learned about Valmiki, how he was called as Adikavi, because he wrote Ramayana, which is the first poem in this, in Sanskritam. And what is the incidence that led him to write Ramayana? Like, you know, two crown japakshis were like a hunter killed one of the crown japakshis, and how that led to the creation of whole Ramayana, right? Do you guys know what is the total number of shlokas in Ramayana? Can anyone tell? Hello? Yeah, please go ahead.
64 million or 64 lakhs?
64 lakhs, that's how much do we have currently right now?
Currently right now is maybe 1,000?
No, we have 24,000 shlokas in Ramayana.
24,000?
You know, 24 is a very interesting number. Like, do you guys all know Gayatri Mantra?
Yes.
Yeah, do you guys know how much letters are there in a Gayatri Mantra? In the Gayatri Mantra that we normally chant?
24 letters.
24 letters, right? And what is the total number of shlokas in Ramayana?
24,000 shlokas.
Yeah, so do you guys see the correlation between 24,000 shlokas in Ramayana?
Yes.
So for each letter, there are 1,000 shlokas in Ramayana. So actually, like, if you go and take a Ramayana book and then see each 1,000th shloka, like, that will have like one letter from Gayatri Mantra. Like, the first shloka in Ramayana is Tapaswadhyaya Niratam. It starts with the letter Ta. And the first letter in the Gayatri Mantra is Ta, right? If you remove Om Bhurbhuvah Svaha, and after that, whatever comes after that, the first letter is Ta, right? So like that, for each, the, like, you know, like each 1,000 shlokas in Ramayana, it starts with one letter from Gayatri Mantra. And who wrote Ramayana?
Valmiki.
Valmiki, yes. Valmiki wrote Ramayana. Who wrote Mahabharata? Which?
Vyasa.
No, Vyasa told Mahabharata, right? Who actually put it in writing?
Lord Ganesha.
Yeah, what was the deal between Vyasa and Ganesha?
Vyasa told and Ganesha wrote.
One person at a time. Can you guys lift your hand? And then I'm going to tell. Okay, Narayana, I see Narayana's hand.
Ganesh wrote, and Vyas Bhagavan, right, told.
Yeah, told. Can Can Aparna Peri, she also lifted her hand, can she tell is the deal between Vyasa and Ganesha?
Ganesha should write without stopping, and Vyasa Maharshi should continue speaking. Like, he should never stop speaking.
Yeah, so Vyasa stop speaking, and what is the condition put forth to Ganesha to write it?
Ganesha should write at the same speed as Vyasa Maharshi speaking.
No, Ganesha should understand whatever Vyasa tells and then write it. If he doesn't understand the meaning of the shloka, Ganesha should not write it. So that was the deal between Vyasa and Ganesha for Mahabharata. Okay? And then what other rishi we learned? Jahnu. Can anyone remember Jahnu Maharishi?
The rishi who swallowed Ganga.
One at a time. I see Archish.
Yeah, he swallowed the Ganga River.
What did Jahanu
he
do?
He swallowed the Ganga River.
Yeah, he swallowed the Ganga River. And that's what has got a name. Do you guys know another name for Ganga?
Jahnavi!
Jahnavi. Good. Why? Why did she get the name Jahnavi?
Because
she was followed by Jahnu Maharishi, Ganga was called as Jahnavi. And who held Ganga in their head?
Lord Shiva.
And I see Hamsini Peri up. Can she tell the name of Lord Shiva that connects him with Ganga?
Gangadhara.
Yeah, Gangadhara. Good, because he got Ganga in his head. That is why he is called as Gangadhara. Awesome, guys. You guys all listened yesterday. Okay. Can you tell me about Parashuram?
Parashurama was born to Bhrigu Maharshi Jamadagni.
Yeah, Parashurama was born to Jamadagni. That's correct. Yeah. And what did Jamadagni do to his wife?
He was about to throw astra at Surya, but the Surya and then Surya came down and bowed on him. So he said, "I'll give you something." So and then he gave something to his wife, Jamadagni's wife.
Okay. Let me stop you right there, Narayana. I see Kaushik as well. Can Kaushik tell what did Jamadagni give to his wife?
So he gave an umbrella and footwear so that she won't like her feet won't get burned in the sand, and like it's really hot because of the sun, and the sun just gave everything so that her wife would be safe and all. And there's one more point. Parasuram is the incarnation of Lord Vishnu.
Wow, you guys know Parasuram is the incarnation of Lord Vishnu. Very good. Do you guys know other incarnations of Lord Vishnu? Somebody can raise their hand. So, Kaushik, you tell me one of the incarnation of Lord Vishnu.
Rama.
Okay, very good. Aparna Peri, can you tell me another incarnation of Lord Vishnu?
Varaha Swami,
very good. And can anybody raise hands? Do you guys know other incarnation? Okay, Hamsini, can you tell other incarnation of Lord Vishnu?
Krishna,
very good. Narayana, can you tell me another incarnation of Lord Vishnu?
Yeah, Janipe.
Narasimha.
Very good. Okay, so now that our Acharya, Rani Sadashiva Garu is here, he's going to excite us with another, you know, another very informative session about all the rishis. You know, you guys, I'm going to have quiz in the next class as well. So please listen to whatever he's saying very, very carefully. He's also going to ask you questions. So be prepared. And I'm also going to ask you questions in the next class, so that I know that you guys all listen, okay? Okay, over to Rani Sadashiva Garuji. Namaste.
Namaskaram. Sarvajnyam sakalagamadi vinutam swarnendu pithasthitam sarvacharyanutam sahasrakamale sadbhavana gocharam सर्वागौघ विनाशिनीं सकलदां संविन्मयीं सर्वगां कामाक्षीं गुरुरूपिणीं हृदि भजे श्रीकामकोट्युज्ज्वलां शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृते वंदे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः अपार करुणासिन्धुं ज्ञानदं शांतरूपिणं श्रीचंद्रशेखर गुरुं प्रणमामि मुदान्वहम् कामकोटिपीठेश्वरं कामाक्षी प्रथमकिंकरं श्रीचंद्रशेखरेन्द्रशिष्यं शंकरार्यं शिवंकरं महादेवानंदनंदनं श्रीजयेन्द्र सरस्वतीं सर्वदेवमयात्मकं वंदे श्रीजगद्गुरुं कामकोटि गुरुपीठाध्यक्षं कामाक्षी प्रतिनिधिं काषायांबरधारिणं तप्तकांचन विग्रहं भस्मोपेतमुखमंडलं दंडधरं अभयंकरं त्रिमूर्त्यात्मकं वंदे श्रीजगद्गुरुं ओं श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः ओं श्री मातृ नमः ओं श्री महागणाधिपतये नमः सदा सरस्वतये नमः टुडे वी आर इन द सेकंड डे ऑफ द सेशन ऑन ऋषि परंपरा सो आई एम थैंकफुल टू द ऑर्गेनाइजर्स particularly to the Tabir, who is introducing me now. And as I was informed by
Shyam Punjab Keshan.
Shyam
Punjab Keshan.
Punjab Keshan is it. Namaskaram. And namaste to all the other respected members who have assembled here. Pranams to all the elders and blessings to all the children. Today, I was informed by Sri Kumbhala Sharma Garu about some questions you posed to me, and having answered those questions, after giving some information further about some more sages, today I am not going to ask you any questions, because I haven't listed out any questions now. Of course, if any questions strike to my mind, I will ask directly. Then the first question which was asked by some of you is, what are the qualifications of a rishi? And here in our Dharma Shastra Grandhas, four qualifications are essential for a rishi. One is Vidya. The second one is Satya, and then the third one is Tapaha, and the fourth one is Shruti. These four make a person a rishi. He need not be with a beard. He need not be living in any forest. Even if he lives among us, if he has these four characteristics, we can call him a rishi. Vidya is first essential thing. What is Vidya? That Vidya is not the Vidya which helps us in earning our food. But the ultimate vidya, particularly the knowledge which was there in the Upanishads, Brahma Sutras, Bhagavad Gita, and other such texts, Moksha Shastra it is called. One who knows, one who has a good knowledge of this vidya, it is the first characteristic of a rishi. When we say it is the first characteristic of rishi, this vidya, how should it help him? Yesterday we were telling that four purusharthas are there. Purushartha means human objectives, the objectives of a life as a human being. They are four in number. Some people want, they are born to deliver their duties as a human being, as a father, as a son, as a brother, as a friend, as an administrator, as a person in society. Like that, the same person has n number of duties, hundreds of duties he has. One who performs all his duties, if he is interested and if he likes or if he loves to deliver his duties through all these portions he is accepting, then we say he is a dutiful person, duty-minded person, dharmic person. Like that we can say. The second one is there. He always concentrates his mind on earning wealth. Earning wealth will be very important issue for him. Such a person is known as Arthajeevi. First one is known as Dharmajeevi. Second one is known as Arthajeevi. To say in lighter terms, while our heart says lub dub lub dub, in Telugu we know money is equivalent of dub. That's why his heart starts beating like dub 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 dub. So he doesn't have anything else. He earns and earns, keeps on earning throughout his life. Till his last breath, he keeps on earning only. He hesitates to spend, but he never hesitates to earn. That person is, such a person is known as Arthajeevi. Third person is there, he is Kamajeevi. Father has earned a lot of money and son starts spending it. He spends money like water and he wants to get every desire of him satisfied with the money earned by father. That a person is known as Kamajeevi. Dharma, Ardhat, and Kama, these are there. And fourth one is there, Moksha Jeevi. Moksha is a very wonderful concept which releases us from the bondage of this birth. How? Everybody wants freedom. That freedom, ultimate freedom, is called Moksha. And at every minute we want freedom. If anybody says, are we free? Do we have freedom? Suppose for children I am asking this question. Do you say that, are we free or not? Do we have freedom? Anybody can tell? Any child. Do we have freedom?
Kaushik wants to answer. Yeah, Kaushik.
Yes. Well, like we have, we have rights to do whatever we want, right? Or
right is sure. Different. Are we? We have freedom.
Yeah, I think.
Yes.
To what extent do we have freedom? Please let me know. To what
extent? Whole life.
Throughout whole the life, do we have freedom? Or at this minute, do we have freedom?
No.
No. Why? If we don't have freedom at this moment, how do you say that throughout life we have freedom?
I will hand out to the Narayana. Okay. Yeah, Narayana?
So we may have freedom because we can we are the only type of things that can reach to God.
Okay, let us forget about God. In the world, in our daily activities, do we have freedom or not?
We do.
Yes. If we have freedom, is it given by parents or do we have naturally freedom? Do we have natural freedom or is it given by our parents? Who gave us?
Freedom is given by parents.
If it is given, can we call it freedom? Freedom
no.
Should be available.
Yeah, it's in nature. Freedom is in nature.
Freedom is in nature. It should be in nature. For instance, air is there or wind is there. Wind wants to blow. Can anyone prevent it from blowing?
No.
No. In a classroom, I want to blow a conch shell. Can I blow it as I do wish?
No.
No. Then
no.
Do I have freedom?
No.
That is why we are always bound. We are not free. Particularly, though we feel that we have freedom, from 9:30 to 12:30 or 12 o'clock, as long as this session is there, we lost our freedom. We have committed to sit in the class. Am I right or not? That's why there are many things which prevent us to utilize our freedom. That's why we are never free. We are always bound. We are always bound. We are always bound in this world by our own conditions, certain times. Sometimes by external conditions. So, like this, there are many reasons, many things which control our freedom. Similarly, when in our day-to-day life, after the class is over, we take a very long breath. Yes, I am free from my commitment of sitting in the class. It is interesting. We want to learn. We want to sit. We want to spend time here. After learning again, yes, my commitment to sit in the class is over now. I am free. Somebody calls us through phone. Are you free now? Yes, they ask us. Yes, I am free. Otherwise, no. I am engaged in a class. That means I don't have freedom to this extent. So freedom, if it is given by others, whether by parents or whether by teachers, whether by friends or whether by any other person, if he says, I have given you full freedom, if he says full freedom is not given, that is not at all freedom. It is conditional movement to move freely in a particular area. It is a kind of arresting only. So, largest area where we can move is the earth. On this earth, we can move from one corner to the other if we have enough money with us. So, beyond earth, we cannot go. So, that is why our freedom ends at the edge of the earth. After that, we cannot move. So, bear all these conditions, we cannot move. That is why freedom means a state where we can do anything, we can grow to any extent, we can meet anyone, not merely under the roof of the sky, even beyond the sky. If anything is there, we must be able to merge in it, to meet it, to deal with it. All these things, if we can do, then we can say we have freedom. A struggle or an attempt, an activity to get such freedom is moksha. Moksha from all worldly responsibilities. That is why that vidya which helps us to attain such a state that is known as moksha vidya, that is known as Upanishad Vidya, that is known as the other Brahma Sutra Vidya and other things. That's why first quality of a Rishi is to have that Vidya. And after that, Satyam. Always we must be able to speak truth only, even under adverse situations. Even in negative situations, we must have capacity to speak truth only, truth only, truth only. Can you give one example? Who used to speak truth alone in our history, in our Puranas? Is there any single person who used to speak only truth? Anybody?
Harishchandra. Harishchandra.
Very good.
Harishchandra
was known, and he was taken as icon of truth. What about Ramachandra? We are speaking about Harishchandra. Another Chandra is there, Ramachandra. Didn't he speak truth?
Yeah, he does.
Yes. But one wonderful thing about Ramachandra is that Harishchandra, throughout his life, followed the principle of speaking truth only. But Ramachandra used to follow all such noble qualities, along with which qualities he used to speak truth only. Not only by himself, for the sake of the words spoken by his father, he went to forest. That was the greatness. That's why speaking truth is such a great vrata. That is why Ramachandra and Harishchandra both were Rajarshis, because of the principle they accepted to speak truth throughout their lives. That is one thing what we have to learn from them. And the third one is tapaha. Yesterday I told you tapas, penance. By doing penance or by performing tapas, one can become Rishi. We have seen the story of Vishwamitra and many others. Tapas is a kind of producing heat inside. For instance, when we keep a vessel over the stove and we light the stove, what will happen? The vessel will turn into red color because of the heat produced there. And if any residues are there in the vessel, they will be burnt into ashes and that vessel will become pure, emerate. Similarly, even in our lives, if we start doing penance, a kind of heat of knowledge is produced. It is not such a heat through which the vessel is burnt, but it is such a heat which can be experienced through knowledge. And the heat of, because of the heat of knowledge, all the sins which we have committed, all the flaws which we have, all the wrong deeds we have committed earlier, they will be cleared and we will become pure. So this is the third quality of a Rishi. And fourth one is Shruti. Shruti is Vedic knowledge. Though Upanishads are a part of Shruti, this Shruti is separated from it. Here in this Shruti, the first three activities, Samhita, Mantra Bhaga, Brahmana, and Aranyakas, these are the three parts of Veda. And through these three parts of Veda, performing of sacrifices, that is Homa, Yajna, Yaga, all these rituals, performing this kind of rituals was assigned to it. And it was recommended to us, a person who always, forever, performs all these types of Vedic rituals, this is a kind of having the knowledge of Shruti. Shruti has four steps in it. Not only Shruti, knowledge of any Shastra or any discipline of knowledge, it has four steps. First one is learning. Then whatever is learnt, understanding it. And third one is putting it in practice. And fourth one is making others also to learn, to understand, to put it in practice. These four steps are known as Adhiti, Bodha, Acharana, and Prachara. These are required. A Rishi has all these four. He learns, he understands, he follows, he makes others to follow it. One who does all these four activities, we can say he is Shrutiman. He has Shruti. So these are four activities. The fifth one is their Atmavan. We have certain things inside. If we don't know that those things are there with us, we are ignorant. One such thing is consciousness, life principle, because of which we are able to speak, we are able to do any activity, we are able to participate in anything, and we are able to listen. All these things because of that life principle is there. If that life departs from us, what we can do is nothing. That's why that the cause of that life is known as self, Atma. And the limit, the power of that Atma is beyond anything. Boundless it is. But we do not know that we have such a capacity. So, but Rishi knows his limitations, his abilities, his capabilities, his skills, his talents, all these things are there. That is why Rishi is different from us, Atmavan. And as a result, there are certain characteristics. How can we know that he is Atmavan? For that, we say, Daya Sarva Bhuteshu. Kindness towards all beings must be there. That is first thing. And then Shantihi, forbearance. When we face some inconvenience, we fight against our parents, we fight against our friends, we fight against even elders, we never count. We fight among us also, with our sister, brother, with our younger sister, our elder sister, younger brother, our elder brother, with all these people, we fight. Because of a feeling that we are losing ourselves. So, without having any such feelings, without becoming a slave of such moods, if we can show some patience, that is known as Shanti. This is second quality required for Rishi. And then Anasuya, not feeling jealous of others' richness, others' virtues, others' progress, others' capacities, and seeing them, we should not feel jealous. That is Anasuya. That is the third quality. Then Saucham, purity. Purity is of many kinds. Particularly, three purities are recommended. Then the fourth one also. First purity is pure speech. Whatever we speak, let us speak very purely from the heart, not from the tongue. That is first purity. The second one is pure thought. The thoughts also should be free from pollutions. Second one, pure speech, pure thought, and pure deed. The third one, manas, vak, karma. This should be pure. That is one thing. The fourth one is pure ahankara. Sattvika guna, that is. Ahankara is the feeling of I-ness. I am Sadashivamurti. That is ahankara. But when some people say, yes, I am Sadashivamurti, if I say that it is a kind of pride, it is impure self, it is. Instead of that, I should say, sir, people call me Sadashivamurti. I offer my salutations to you. Like that, when elders come and ask us, we should bow down our heads to them. That is known as pure ahankara. So this kind of purity in ahankara is required for us. This is one kind. So saucham, these of these four kinds, another purity also is there. purity of intellect, non-polluted thoughts. How thoughts can be prevented from being polluted? That is, not copying the thoughts of others. Originality should be there in our thinking. If somebody says something, yes, that is my thought only. Like that, if we cling to piracy, it is purity, it is impure only. Then, anayasaha, effortlessly, we should face difficulties or we should meet with any kind of troubles, etc. And we should not feel troubled. Let us face the situation. That should be there. And after that, mangalam, being desirous of auspiciousness. This is one thing. And akarpanyam, not having any submissiveness. Not to obeying is different. Submissiveness is, unwanted submissiveness is karpanyam. That should not be there. And aspruha, not showing interest towards the things which are not others. A person who has these qualities is a rishi. For the time being, this can be an answer. So yesterday we have given different types of rishis. Brahmarishis are there. Devarshis are there, Maharshis are there, Rishis are there, Shrutarshi, and who studies Vedas and because of which he is called Rishi, and Rajarshi is there, Royal Rishi. Like this, there are different kinds of Rishis. For instance, let us take Jimutavahana's life. Have you ever heard the name of Jimutavahana?
No.
Who is Jimutavahana?
No.
Who wants to tell? Narayana.
We never heard about Jimutavahana.
So okay, there are certain divine clans. As we have different clans among human beings, there are certain divine clans. Yakshas, Kinnaras, Kimpurushas, Vidyadharas, Nagas, Garudas, like this. All these are divine clans. Some classes in among gods. Kinnaras, Kimpurushas, Echa Kinnara, Kimpurusha, Gandharva, Vidyadharas and others. So this Jimutavahana was a young prince belonging to Vidyadhara clan. And his father wanted to go to the forest, having attached Jimutavahana the kingdom. He wanted to make him the king of the Vijayadhara kingdom, and he wanted to quit the kingdom. He wanted to go to forest. So Jimutavahana's father went to forest. Now he became the king, Jimutavahana. Soon after that, he goes to the forest to meet his father. He wanted to greet his father. Then, on seeing the beauty of the forest, he says, Shaya Shadvalam Asanam Suchisila Sadmadrumana Mataha Chitam Nirjara Varipanam Asanam Kandaha Sahaya Mrigaha Itya Pradhita Labhyasarva Vipavi Doshoyamekovani Dushprapardhini Yaparartha Ghatana Vandyaihi Vridhastiyate. He says, if we want to sleep in a Antapura, in a royal palace, we need different types of beautiful beds. We purchase them. Even while sleeping on the beds, we may not get proper sleep. But here in the forest, we have the green grassy lands over which we can sleep very comfortably. So Shadvala Bhumi is there. Shadvala Bhumi means grassy land. That's why grassy lands are just beautiful beds for us in this forest. Asanam Suchisila. From one side of the forest, there are streams of water flowing from top of the hill towards the ground. There, because of the flowing water, all the stones were cleaned very neatly. Those well-cleaned stones are beautiful chairs for me. We can sit anywhere. Nobody will come for any competition. Sadmadrumana Mataha. Very thick shade trees are there. Those trees are my houses. That's why I can select any tree under the surface of that tree. Beneath that tree, we can sleep comfortably. That is also is there. Shitam nirjaravari panam. If we want to drink water, the stream which is coming from the top of the hill, we can fill our hands with that water and we can drink. That's also is possible. That water is more powerful also in giving us a lot of energy, because through the Oshadhi Vanas, herbal lands, that water is flowing. That is why it is powerful. Chitam nirjaravari panam asanam kandaha. If we feel hungry, we can dig anywhere near the creepers and we can get roots and fruits on the top of the tree. Those will fill our stomach and they satisfy our hunger. So fruits are available, roots are available. Sahayaha mrigaha. So who are my friends? All the animals in the forest. But there is only one weakness here. If I want to help to others, I don't find any other person, he says. That's why whatever is available to me, all that is available to others also. When such free availability of all the things are there, who will come to take my help? That is why without helping others, if I want to live, that's a waste way of living. So I don't want to lead such a life, he says. So having such principle to help others also is a kind of Rishi nature. He is a prince, very young prince. Even at young age, he got such thoughts. That is greatness. So forests are like that. So this is the first answer to the first question, that is, the qualifications of Rishi are these. And then, what they give to universe? Actually, this is an interesting question. And at the same time, what should they give to us? They gave a name for us, Bharata Desha. First thing, what they have given? We belong to the country where all such great people lived and who called this nation as Bharata Desha. That's why they have given us the term Bharata Desha. What is the state of Bharata Desha? What is the rank of Bharata Desha? Please don't count in physical wealth or any other things. From the knowledge point of view, what is our knowledge also not in the universities, etc. These are all only degrees. They help us to earn our bread only. But they cannot help us to earning our values. Our values through education are given by our ancient seers to us. That is our Bharat Desha. Don't we feel proud of saying that we belong to Bharat Desha? Anybody else? Anybody from our children? Don't we feel proud of?
Yes, we do.
Thank you. Great. So, we belong to Bharat Desha. That is a great thing.
Yeah.
Who gave this country Bharat, the name Bharat? Who did give this name Bharat to this country?
Bharat.
Yeah, Priya Radhakrishnan.
Is it Bharata?
Bharata. It is called Bharata Desha. And that name was popularized through the rishis only. That is why. Who popularized this? Vedavyasa wrote in all the Puranas that this country's name is Bharata Desha. We belong to this country. That's why we are all Bharatiyas. From which date or from which year we are started to be called as Bharatiyas? Which was the first year from which we have been called Bharatiyas?
Anyone can answer it? Yesterday, it is already mentioned.
Told.
Okay, yeah, please go ahead, sir.
That is why long ago, some yugas back, during the period of Vishwamitra, the son of Shakuntala, Bharata, when he ruled us, our country was being started called Bharata Desha. That's why it was not in the last year or some 50 years back or 100 years back or 1000 years back, some millennia back, but some long ago from that point of time. That is why that was popularized by the sages like Vedavyasa. That's why the name Bharat was given to us through the sages. What should they give than this? A great heritage. I belong to a particular family. It is a great thing. Similarly, I belong to a particular country. Yes, it is a great thing. That owning a citizenship of country by birth was gifted to us by our seer sages. That is why, that is what the seers gave to us. Then a code of discipline, a wonderful way of living was given. How should we live? Just like our seers lived. How did they live? In the beginning, I have given you certain qualities of sages. What are they? Daya Bhuteshu, Shanti, Shanti, Anasuya, all these are qualities. So we can accept all those. We can speak truth like Satcharishchandra. We can develop the habit of helping others like Jimutavahana. And we can follow our duties as Sri Ramachandra. So in this manner, every king, every sage, every Maharishi, every great man of this land has given us some principles. Those principles were popularized through the texts of these rishis. That's why, what should they give them this? And they give, what else they have given? Here, I will list out certain astonishing things which were given by our seers to the world. That is, we know that all the sages were good at penance, doing tapas. Very interestingly, there was a concept of ashram in our ancient texts. How the ashram was called, which place was called an ashram? It is not merely a poor thatched hut, but Rishinam or Muninam Dasasahasram Yaha Annapanadi Poshanat Adhyapayati Viprarshihi Asau Kulapatis Brataha. An ashram of ancient times was a learning center, but not an earning center. Ashram was a learning center in our ancient times. How many students used to study there? Every student was called Muni because while learning, they advised us to follow silence. I will tell you the secret of being silent. That's why Muninam Dasasahasram. In an ashram, they used to accommodate 10,000 students. There are four stages of life in our human life. First one is Brahmacharya, pre-married life. And The second one is Grihastashrama, married life. Third one is Vanaprasthashrama, post-married life, after spending some 20 or 25 years or 30 years of span, they want to take a decision to go to forest and stay there. That is known as Vanaprastha. And after that, finally accepting sannyasa. These are the four steps. All the brahmacharis are pre-married life, people in pre-married life. They used to go to these ashramas for studying. All the ashramas were located in forests. So forests were not left unused. All the forests were used. Those forests were of two types. One is Rishirakshita Aranyas and Rakshasa Bhakshita Aranyas. Rishirakshitas, which were under the care of rishis. Those aranyas or those forests were known as ashrams. In each ashram, 10,000 students use it to study. And to teach every 10 students, there was one teacher who is again a rishi without having attachment to worldly things. He used to teach only knowledge, knowledge and knowledge. That's why there are 350 shastras, 18 Mahavidyas, 64 fine arts, 700 Panchalikalas. All these were different types of disciplines of knowledge taught to these students. Whatever we want to learn, we can learn. So, what were offered by these sages? Interestingly, I have a list before you. One is Shakti Tantra. The title of the book was Shakti Tantra. And this was written by Agastya, the sage Agastya we know. What were the great deeds of Agastya? Tell me two great deeds of Agastya, any one of you?
He wrote Ramayanam. He there's two. One is he lowered in Telugu lo
cheppu.
విజయపర్వతాన్ని గర్వ విమోచనం ఒకటి వాతాపిని
సంహరించడం అనేది నిన్న మనం ఇంకొకటి వాట్ ఈస్ ద అదర్ వన్
ఇంకొకటి రావణుడికి ఆతిథ్య హృదయం చెప్పడం
రామునికి ఆతిథ్య హృదయం చెప్పడం ఇట్ ఈస్ ఆల్సో ఏ గ్రేట్ థింగ్ And another great thing also is there. What is that?
Ramadki Panchavati padam. Indradhanasu Panchavati ki vellamani cheppadam.
Okay, all these things. And he kept the entire whole samudra in his commander. Such a great one, Agastya was. To look, he is very short in size. But his deeds were very great. So he commanded Vindhyaparvata to go down till he comes back. From north to south, he wanted to travel. Then he asked Vindhyaparvata to go down. And when he bowed down, he told, till I come back, you please wait here itself. You should stay in this position only, he said. Okay. He laid down and he crossed and he entered south. He settled in deep south, that is Tamil Nadu area. So that Agastya wrote this Shakti Tantra, which is a source for different kinds of electricity. 96 varieties of electricity were mentioned in this Shakti Tantra. There are lots of descriptions of these power types of 96 types of electricity. Text is available. So, Maharshis were first generation scientists of Vedic times. That is why a Maharshi is not merely a person with beard, but this one, Shakti Tantra. Then the second one is Ashwalayana Maharshi. He is another Maharshi. He wrote Agatattva Lahari. This is about dealing with the study of poisons. How many kinds of poisons are there? How to use them? How to identify them? How to get ourselves protected from the effect of poisons? All these things were described there.
That sir, is the... can you repeat the name of the Rishi and because it's a voice break happened. Can you
repeat? Ashvalayana Maharshi. His name is Ashvalayana Maharshi. He wrote Agatattva Lahari. This is. And here, some more things he explained here is Praninas Chidamshat. So, which are called beings with life and which are not called, which are sentient objects and which are insentient objects, which are movables and which are immovables, this kind of classification he made, and how life enters into a human being also was explained by him in this Agatattva Lahari. Particularly, this was about the poisons, types of poisons, etc. So, Ashvalayana Maharshi wrote this text. We have to search for it. Then, the third one is Bharadwaja Maharshi. Bharadwaja Maharshi wrote many textbooks. One such textbook is Amshubodhini. Amshubodhini was another text written by Bharadwaja Maharshi. And he mentioned about the light, velocity of light, heat, sound, and all these things. So, his text Amshubodhini speaks about the light, heat, sound, etc. Particularly, we know that sparklings can be seen, lightning can be seen in the sky. But Bharadwaja, in his text, mentioned how to catch that lightning also. It just in split seconds disappears from our vision. Still, we can catch and we can collect electricity from it and we can utilize it. Such things were explained by him. This is Bharadwaja's Amshubodhini Tantra. It is partly available. Similarly, Bharadwaja's another text is Yantra Sarvasva. This text is available with Gaikwad Oriental series of Baroda, in which he mentioned about this text has 96 chapters in it. The 40th chapter of this deals with Vaimanika Tantra, methods of preparing different types of vimanas, aeroplanes. And the number of these aeroplanes was 56 types of aeroplanes, how to design them, which can be the fuel. Regarding fuel, he says, even this mercury can be used as fuel in preparing, in building the aeroplanes, he mentioned. This is 40th chapter, Vaimanika Adhikarana, it is known as. And the rest of the chapters, each of them deal with a kind of different types of sciences. Particularly, all these chapters help us in preparing different kinds of machines. Yantra Sarvasva, its name. Bruhat Yantra Sarvasva, very large text in which the designs of different types of machines, preparing different types of machines is mentioned. And we know very few metals to our knowledge, but he mentions, he gives a reference to more than 100 metals, pure metals, not alloys. What is the difference between an alloy and a pure metal?
An alloy is a mixed metal and a pure metal is just metal itself. Alloy is like a mix of a few metals.
Very good, very good. So, According to him, there are, from the permutations and combinations of different metals, hundreds of alloys or thousands of alloys can be produced. But pure metals listed by him are 100 in number. How to collect those metals also was given by him. That was Bharadwaja's Brihadyantra Sarvastra. And after that, the second one is Angiro Maharshi. We know Angiro Maharshi. This Angiro Maharshi has written a book named Meghotpatti Prakarana. We see clouds in the sky. We know that seasoning the clouds, seeding the clouds, and getting rain from the clouds which are there through human efforts, all these things are known to the modern world. But in ancient times, he wrote in this book, Meghotpatti Prakarana, through certain processes, we can create meghas in the sky, clouds in the sky, and those clouds can shower rains whenever we want. Such methods were mentioned by Angiro Maharshi. And he mentioned there about the lightnings and thunderbolts also, different kinds of thunderbolts. From the color of thunderbolt, is it useful to the mankind? Is it harmful to the mankind? Such things also can be decided. In fact, thunderbolt doesn't have color. The lightning has color. After we see the lightning, slowly we hear the sound of thunderbolt. It falls somewhere. So from the color of the lightning, we can say what kind of thunderbolt it is. Is it harmful or useful to the mankind? How it is useful to the mankind? Certain kinds of thunderbolts, when they fall upon the earth, some thousands of hectares of land becomes pure and fertile. That was mentioned in Meghotpatti Prakarana and also in many other texts. They were all sages only. And Bharadwaja's another text was Akasha Tantra. So this Akasha Tantra gives the details of seven layers of Akasha, seven types of Akasha. Akasha is not sky, it is ether. And seven kinds of ether. And how to use the powers in different regions of the ether for the welfare of mankind, it was mentioned by him in the Akasha. After that, Vivaranacharya, he was also an ancient sage. He wrote a book named Loka Sangraha. Loka Sangraha was the name of the text written by Vivaranacharya. And in that Vivaranacharya's Loka Sangraha, he mentions about the existence of 1,714 languages of ancient times, not of modern times. So he mentioned about 1,714 languages and then different species of animals and different types of food habits of different people and different ways of living on the surface of earth. All these were mentioned there in the Loka Sangraha. The name of the sage who wrote this was Vivarana Acharya. Vivarana Acharya, yes. Then Shaktayana Maharshi. Shaktayana Maharshi, he wrote Vayu Tattva Prakarana. He speaks about 84,000 vayus, winds, 84,000 winds were mentioned by him. And the influence of these winds over innumerable number of herbal plants and very big trees also. As a result of which, the herbal treasures will be useful to the human beings. Every text which was written by the sages were useful to the mankind only, but not just because I want to write a book, That's why I wrote a book. Whether it is useful to, for others or not, it doesn't matter. It is not my job. Like that, it was not the way of living of the sages. Manava Kalyanartham, for the good of human beings, he wrote all this. That is why this is Vayu Tattva Prakarana of Shaktayana. And Vaishvanara Tantra, this is a way of explaining about 128 types of fires. This was written by Sage Narada. Particularly, when we mention the name Narada in the Telugu region, Telugu people, what do? What for the Sage Narada popular? Anybody?
Battling?
Pardon? Repeat?
Pullal
Bartada. So, he is the cause for, he creates quarrels among the people. Kalaha Bhojana. He eats the quarrels of others. This is the popularity given to Narada by our Telugu people. Unfortunately, it is not true. Narada was a great philosopher. Narada was a great devotee of Vishnu. Narada was a great scientist. He wrote this Narada Maharshi Krita Vaishvanara Tantra. Vaishvanara means fire. Vaishvanara Tantra was written by Narada. In Sanskrit texts, they never speak of Narada as a person of quarrels. But in Telugu only, they developed and popularized it like this. We have to change our mind. So, Narada was very much adored, says, in our ancient times, according to Sanskrit Puranas. We wanted to create a fun through the character of Narada. And accordingly, we say that Narada is such a person. But it is not true. That is why he wrote Vaishvanara Tantra. And the colors of fire, the qualities of fire, the uses of fire, the heat of the fire, all these things were described there. 128 types of fire are available in the text of Narada. And Narada Maharshi wrote another text named Dhuma Prakarana, smokes. These smokes are in different colors, and that smoke can have a kind of taste also. Sweet smoke, savor smoke, and salty smoke. Like that, there are different kinds of smokes. And Narada Maharshi wrote Dhuma Prakarana also. And after that, another Ishvara says, the name of says Ishvara is not Lord Shiva. He wrote Saudamini Kala. Here, we have different kinds of electricity. He has given names also, very interestingly. Varuni, Agnimukha, Danda, Mahat, Ravinika, Rohini, Chalana, Kampana, Urdhva, Adhara, Mandala, Vegini, Anuloma, Tiriyanchi, Parangmukhi, Vilomastambana, Chitrini, all these are types of electricity. And Saudamini Kala is the name of the text written by Ishvara, where all these types of electricity were described. Each kind of electricity has a particular purpose. And it can be used for that purpose. So this is Ishvara's writing. And another one is Kriyasara Tantra. This Kriyasara Tantra is a text mentioned by Bharadvaja in his Brihadyantra Sarvasva. And this Kriyasara Tantra speaks of 3,07,003,221 comets. We know about a comet. We can very rarely see comets in the sky. But he counted the number of comets in the universe, not merely in the visible sky. The number of such comets in the universe, according to him, were 3,221 comets were there. And after that, out of those, electric-wombed comets were 8,000. And again, among them, some 12 comets were very important. Rochisha, Dahika, Simhika, Patangika, and others. These are, again, he says, during the summer, they come into contact with the sun and they release certain rays for the welfare of the human world, he says. So that is Kriyasara Tantra, a text available. A reference to this text is available in the Brihadyantra Sarvasva of Bharadvaja. Then Valmiki Maharshi. We know Valmiki Maharshi as the author of Ramayana, but this Valmiki Maharshi is not merely a sage who wrote Ramayana, but he wrote a kind of mathematics named Valmiki Ganitam. It was the name of the text. Valmiki Ganitam was the name of the text written by Valmiki. And here, different types of mathematics were mentioned. And after that, Narayana Rishi, he wrote Vimana Chandrika. This Vimana Chandrika is a text on building aeroplanes. So, in his text, he mentioned different sages like Agnimitra, Garga, Chakrayani, Dandinatha, Parashara, Bodhayana, Vasishta, Vachaspati, Vyasa, Spotayana, like that 50 to 60 Maharshis were mentioned by him. And some of the texts written by them on the science of aeronautics were Yantrakalpa, Ketayana Pradipika, Andakaustubha, Brahmandasara, like this. They wrote more than 130 texts, 30 treatises of this kind. So that was the contribution of the sages to the mankind. So this is one part. So that is why, what do we wish from the sages than this? So they have given us worldly knowledge of worldly living. They have given us moksha vidya. They have given us certain wonderful modern, which are equivalent to modern scientific thoughts. Such texts also were written by them. What else is to be written by? That is why sages have given of this kind. And why they are relevant forever? Should I answer this question? After giving reference to all these texts and other things also, should I answer this question? My dear children, please let me know.
No.
Why? It is clearly evident from the texts which were offered by those people that they have gifted the mankind with a grand literature. Values were given. A name was given to our country. They have given identity for us. Everything was given. Only thing is, we are ignoring those sages. But sages never ignored us. Wonderfully, Ramayana and Mahabharata, these two are enough for many thousands and thousands of centuries to proudly say that we belong to this tradition where Ramayana was produced, where Mahabharata was produced. About the greatness of these two texts, we will be learning in future time. That's why I reserve my content over Ramayana and Mahabharata for my future interaction with you all. That is why I'm not speaking much about this. All this was given to us by the Sejaswami. See why we should remember them. Another reason is, if I have prepared certain things, what do you expect from the society? I want to sell these things to the society. I want to offer these things only by receiving, collecting some money from them, but not with any selfless attitude. But seers, what did they expect from you? Just a kind of tarpanas. Somebody asked, why should we offer tarpanas to those sages? So this is. And here we have different types of names of the sages. Brahmadayo devastam tarpayami deva tarpana, this is. And rishis, rishi tarpana. Krishna dvaipayanadayo erushehatan rishigumstarpayami tarpayami. Tarpana, offering tarpana is to satisfy them, to please them by remembering their names. On the day of a great person's birthday, we recollect his name. What for? Does he listen to us? Is he with us? Chhatrapati Shivaji's birthday we celebrate. Why do we celebrate Chhatrapati Shivaji's birthday? Can anyone?
In his honor, we will remember him.
So, like that, he belongs to our tradition and he tried to protect our tradition for its sake, for the sake of protecting our tradition, he sacrificed his lives. That's why we memorize him. We celebrate his birthday. Like that, there are several great men among us. All those people also can be called rishis only. Because selflessly, they tried to serve our nation, serve the mankind. Similarly, these sages, right from beginning, from Krishna Dvaipaya, Vedavyasa, Sarvam Rishigams Tarpayami Tarpayami, I satisfy all the rishis through these offerings of water to them. In the name of them, we offer holy waters. We feel that these offerings, this Mantraputa offering, should reach them. And then Sarvan Rishiganan Sarpayami, Rishipatni Sarpayami, Rishiputran Sarpayami. I please the sages, I please their wises with my reverence, I please the children of those sages, and Pautragum Sarpayami. I please the grandsons and great grandsons of those rishis, Bhurishigam Starpayami. I please the sages who are on this earth, Bhuva Rishigam Starpayami. Actually, there are different seers and sages of different regions of the other worlds, upper worlds, Bhuloka, Bhuvarloka, Suvarloka, Maharloka, Janaloka, Tapoloka, Satyaloka, all these are there. In every loka, in every region upper world, there were seers. I please all of them, one after one, like that. And Bhurbhu Svaka Rishigam Starpayami. So Prajapatim Kandarshin Tarpayami, Soma Kandarshin Tarpayami, Agni Kandarshin Tarpayami, Viswan Devan Kandarshin Starpayami, Sagumhitir Higuntihi, Devataha Upanishadastarpayami, Yajnikir Devataha Upanishadastarpayami, Varunir Devataha Upanishadastarpayami, Havyavaham Tarpayami. Like this, there is a grand list. What for all this? Because selfless, without a selfless thought, they offered their lives for us. They offered great knowledge for us. They have given a beautiful life. They have given a shape to our lives. Particularly, take Yajnavalkya. Yajnavalkya wrote a smriti. And through that smriti, very interestingly, have you ever heard the name IPC? Children?
No.
Indian penal code is known as IPC. So it is the code of conduct, and it is the code according to which we punish the criminals. That is known as IPC. That IPC is nothing else than Yajnavalka Smriti. Yajnavalka Smriti rewritten is known as IPC. Of course, they have taken the support of other modern texts. The main text, main structure of the text is taken from Yajnavalka Smriti. He was a great sage. He didn't expect any patent right over the book written by him. If we write a 100 pages book without any hesitation, we apply for patent right. But they have gifted us, my dear children. The children need not get birth from a person's womb. If they belong to the same country where that great person was born, all the next generations, successive generations of him, are his children only. We are all the children of those great sages. That's why the sages, with great affection, they always protect us. One interesting thing I would like to tell you. Mahabharata war was over. After the Mahabharata war, Rajasuya Yaga also was performed again. Ashwamedha Yaga was performed. And after Ashwamedha Yaga, Arjuna and Krishna were coming back to Hastinapura. And when they reached Hastinapura, Dharmaraja and others received them with great affection. And Arjuna, Krishna accepted the Argya and this reverence offered to him by Krishna, by Yudhishthira, Dharmaraja. And after that, having left Arjuna in the kingdom of Hastinapura, of which the ruler is Yudhishthira, after the war between the Pandavas and Duryodhana's army, after that, having left Arjuna there, he started to Dwaraka. Krishna started to Dwaraka. On his way, he saw a very old sage. In the beginning of Mahabharata, there was description of this sage's story, where the same old person was very young. His name was Uttanka. In Telugu, we call him as Udanka. Have you ever heard the story of Uttanka?
No.
Yes.
So that Uttanka, really, when he was young, he was a very powerful young boy. You also should grow so powerful as Uttanka. But this Uttanka now has grown up old, and that old Uttanka, while he was in ashram, which ashram was on the way of Krishna to Dwaraka. Wherever sages are there, it was the habit of great people like Dharmaraja, Krishna and others to stay there and offer their salutations to them and to receive the teachings of them. That's why he stayed there, Krishna stayed there, and he offered his salutations to Uttanka. And then Uttanka asked, "My dear Krishna, I know you are a great person of our age, and you are very great that we do not have any other thought except helping all the people. But I would like to know, you are the relative of both Pandavas and Kauravas. So when you are the relative of Pandavas and Kauravas, I heard long back that they had enmity. How are these people now? How are Kauravas? Have you settled the quarrel between these two?" And have you allowed them to live happily? Because you are a very wise man. Uttanka knows Krishna as a wise man only. He doesn't know the divinity of Krishna. And that's why very casually he was speaking. And I wanted to know from you how the state of these Pandavas and the Kauravas, he asked. In fact, he doesn't know anything about the war happened and in which all the Duryodhana and his brothers were killed. All these things were not known to him. That's why he asked. Please give me information about those people. Are they happy? If they are happy, I am happy. Because I want the entire world to be peaceful. Then Krishna told, yes, the world is peaceful and the quarrel is settled not by allowing all to live happily, but by sending the army of Kauravas, particularly army of Duryodhana and his brothers, to the heavens. They are forced to send them to the heavens because they didn't listen to our good words. They invited war only. So we were forced to kill them all. So Pandavas killed. On which side you were? He asked. Uttanka asked Krishna. I was on the side of Pandavas only. So you are a lover of wars. That's why you allowed Duryodhana and others to be killed. Unbearable truth this is. You being such a wise person, you didn't stop the war between this Pandavas and Duryodhana's army. What a cruel person you are. I want to take water into my hands and sprinkle upon you. I want to curse you, he said. No, please have patience. They didn't behave properly. That's why they were killed. So they were bad men. Because they were bad, they were killed like that, he told. I don't want all these explanations. I want to give you a curse, he said. Then Krishna told Uttanka, do you think that I am an ordinary person? Now you see my great form of Vishwarupa, which was shown to Arjuna. This is a better form of Vishwarupa I am showing you. Larger form of Vishwarupa, which was not seen by even Arjuna. Such a great Vishwarupa I will show you, he told. Because this Uttanga is not an ordinary person. He belongs to the clan of Bhrigu, the sage Bhrigu. That sage Bhrigu was ancestor of Lakshmi, in the race of which goddess Lakshmi was once born. That's why Lakshmi was known as Bhargavi. And this Bhrigu's race, in the same race he was born. In the same race, the Guru of Demons also was born. Who was the Guru of Demons?
Shukracharya.
Shukracharya!
Very good.
That's sir, right. Last 5 minutes, sir.
I will wind up.
Okay. We can ask any questions, sir, before...
I will wind up the story.
Okay, sir.
This is very much essential.
Yeah. Please go ahead, sir.
Yes. So, this person told, he was very angry. So, I am showing you the great Vishwarupa, he told, and he exhibited his Vishwarupa. When he presented his Vishwarupa, he stunned for a while. He didn't have anything to say in return. You are such a great God. That's why you know good and bad. That's why I cannot tell you anything further. Like that he told. I am thankful to you. Having said these things, he offered his prayers. Then Krishna asked, you ask for a boon, I will give you. He told. Okay, since you told to give me a boon, I need only one thing. See the greatness of that person. He asked for, whenever I want, I should get water. Because I am staying in the region of Rajasthan, which is full of deserts. Here people do not have water. So if you help me, I will I will get water and I will supply that water to all the people who are living in Rajasthan region, he told. But by the time he has committed a sin that was noticed by all gods, but Krishna didn't feel for it. Okay, you will get water. I am giving you a boon, he told. After that, he came back on his way back to Dwaraka. While he was proceeding to Dwaraka, he met Indra. He called Indra and ordered him to give supply water to that Uttanka. Then Indra denied. I deny for two reasons. One is he insulted you. He wanted to prepare to curse you. The second one is he belongs to the race of Shukracharya. Because Shukracharya is the guru of demons, I have some hatred towards this Uttanka also. I don't want to give him any water, he told. No, no, you please give him water because you are the lord of Meghas, the clouds. That's why you should give water, like that he told. And okay, in whichever form and in whichever way I offer him water, he must accept. Under that condition, I will give you water. Somehow you give water, like that he told, and he went to Dwaraka. And after 15 to 20 days, again, he was passing through the ashram of Uttanka. Then he saw Uttanka and asked, how are you, Uttanka? Uttanka this time also got angry with Krishna. And he told, what nonsense you have done. I asked for water. You told that you would be giving. So when I wished for water, a naked man came with very ugly form and with some inconvenient appearance. So he approached me. He wanted to offer me water, which was half drinken by him. And he wanted to offer that water to me. I denied. I refused. You have done a great mistake, like that he told. Then he called Indra and asked, what happened? Why did you do like this? Then he told, he must have identified me because he says he behaved like a human being only and he didn't identify. And I, in fact, because of your words, I wanted to offer him Amrita in the form of water. Whichever I drank, the same Amrita I wanted to offer to him. He didn't accept. So it is his mistake, he told. Okay, you go back, he told. And this time, my dear Uttanka, I am giving you a boon. What is that? That boon is like this. I will give you some clouds. Whenever you call those clouds, they come and they shower in whichever area you wish them to shower, he told. And the names of those clouds are Uttanka Meghas. The names of those clouds are Uttanka Meghas. Ever since, as long as Uttanka lived, there was no dearth for water in the Rajasthan region. While going to heavens at the time of his departing his body, what did he do? He asked those clouds permanently to settle in the Rajasthan area to shower water. Even today, there is a belief among the people that Uttanka Meghas shower very plentifully. In plentitude, they shower waters. How to distinguish Uttanka Meghas? Actually, Pushkara Meghas, Avartaka Meghas, Droni Meghas, like this, there are several kinds of Meghas. What is the peculiarity of this Uttanka Meghas? They say that Uttanka Meghas, the water of Uttanka Meghas is very much fertile. It makes the lands fertile and it is very sweet to be drunk. So, such Meghas were created. Our sages were such great people. They lived for the happiness of mankind, for the well-being of mankind, for the well-being of all of us. So, what else should be learned from the lives of such great people? With these words, I would like to conclude. And Sarmagaru, I request Sarmagaru to
yes, sir. Yeah, we are. Thank you, sir. We are not stopping here. here in the future, we are going to give a lot of more information on the rishis to the to all the participants in a different sections and different times we'll give it. For time being, yes, rishi section we are including, and tomorrow it will be Guru Parampara. Sir, you said like we will some questions to the participants to work on those papers and all the stuff, sir. Can you just explain them that?
Yes, yes. Actually, they are not questions. We will assign you some assignment. We will give you some assignment.
Okay, sir.
Each one of you, I will give you a list of sages. Each one of us should choose one sage, and we should write about his biography from different sources, not only from Google, from different textbooks, ancient textbooks. May it be from translations of the text. You can refer to. I can give you the source also.
Okay,
from
sir.
Mahabharata.
Yeah.
So, like
yeah.
So everyone of you should give the biography of one sage, like that. Let us collect the biographies of at least 100 sages. So this will be textualized, and in the encyclopedia of our children, we will preserve them in our own names. That's why it will be useful for future generations. You can become Bala Rishis, young Rishis. That is
yes. Okay, sir. Yeah, certainly. Yeah, we will give all the references and the resources required for that, and we will help you all participants to complete those assignments in a month time, and then after that we will do it again, evaluate that, and we will give a place to the all the articles and everything in our Dharma Moolam. We will create a platform so that it will be placed there, and as you sir said, like we will certainly make all of you see that is the Bal Rishis. And yes, sir. Anything else, sir, you want to say, share or something before the...
No, nothing. So,
thank you. Thank you, kids. And we will talk a little more in next meeting. And I will conclude this. Thank you.
I thank all the elders who very patiently listened to my speech. And I offer my sincere salutations to Swamiji. And I thank Sharma Garu, and I congratulate and bless all the children for learning about our ancient seers. And with this, I take leave for the time being. Namaskar to
yes, everyone. Sir. Okay, we have another section. Storytelling section is going to start now, sir. So we have.
Okay.
It is the Panchatantra is starting today. So, all the below 13 years, some few kids from this section also going to join there. So, another 10 minutes. Yeah. Okay, sir.
Great thing. Great thing. Namaskar.
Namaskar.
Namaste.
Dhanyavada Murthy garu.
Punah milamaha.
Dhanyavada Punah milamaha. Shubharatri.
Namaste.
Dhanyavada Punah milamaha. Mahalaya Shubharatri.
Dhanyavada.
Asmakam Shubharatri Bhavatam Shubhajana.
Aam.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sami.
Shubhamastu.